Super Saturday has finally arrived. The Las Vegas Strip is talking about one event and one event only. It is Liddell Couture 3 for the UFC Light Heavyweight Championship. Inside the sold-out Mandalay Bay Event Center, we are set for truly the biggest night in the history of the UFC. Many anticipated this matchup would take place in the heavyweight finale of The Ultimate Fighter 2. Instead, tonight, they collide at, check this, 205 pounds. Iron Mike Whitehead was the unofficial team captain on the Hughes team during Season 2 of The Ultimate Fighter. When it came his time to fight on Episode 9 against Rashad Evans, Mike seemed to suffer a mental meltdown and lost a lethargic 3-round decision. What no one was aware of at the time is that Mike was suffering from a major staph infection that he feels sapped him of his energy. Now he has the opportunity to show what kind of fighter he really is.
I want to let my hands go. I want to let everything go. You know, I want to end it quick. And if it doesn't, I'll just punish him.
Like his stablemate Diego Sanchez, the Dean of Mean, Keith Jardine, is a black belt in Gaidu Jutsu under Greg Jackson. Jardine feels equally comfortable grappling or striking. At the Ultimate Fighter 2 season finale, Jardine used his speed to take out the much larger Kerry Shaw with leg kicks in the second round. Tonight, Keith is dropping down to the light heavyweight division where he feels he can truly excel.
I think he can't stand toe-to-toe with me. I don't think he can punch with me, and I should knock him out.
Coming up next, Iron Mike Whitehead takes on the Dean of Mean, Keith Jardine. Our tale of the tape is brought to you by Zions Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. Jardine, 6 years the elder of the highly touted Mike Whitehead. Will we see the real Mike Whitehead here this evening?
When the action begins, our referee in charge of this contest is Steve Mazzagatti.
So Steve Mazzagatti, our referee, and I have a feeling that Iron Mike Whitehead is going to look for the early knockout. He is known to have hands of steel, also good wrestling skills, but he may swing for the fences early. Jardine and Whitehead meet in the octagon here at Mandalay Bay.
I had always heard great things about Mike Whitehead, and I was a little disappointed watching that fight. You know, he looked a little lethargic against Rashad, and Rashad is no joke. Rashad is an excellent athlete. He's a very good wrestler. He put on a great fight, but it wasn't the Mike Whitehead that I had heard of. And now that you find out about the staph infection, you find out that he went into that severely compromised. We're going to get to see the real Mike Whitehead tonight, I hope.
I mean, and this was a heavyweight competitor in the Ultimate Fighter number 2, Joe, that actually was outworking cardio-wise the little guys. And there's the double leg and the great wrestling skills of Mike Whitehead. But he was supposed to be the most fit of all the athletes going into that competition.
That was the knock on him.
Now again,
nice takedown.
An Iowa guy, you know, Medford, Oregon, now out of Salt Lake City, but in with the Iowa guys and known as a very good wrestler is Mike Whitehead, looking to pass guard here. Matt Hughes actually within our listening distance yelling at Whitehead to go to pass the guard.
Keith Jardine has excellent guard. He has an excellent guard. He also has excellent takedown defense. My good friend Tate Fletcher's worked out with him over at Greg Jackson's camps, and he had nothing better to say. Excuse me, nothing but good things to say about Keith Jardine.
Going to try to take the leg again. Now, again, you've talked to me before, Joe, that this is extremely exhausting, though, when you're trying to make that opponent go down and fighting so hard to get another takedown.
Well, I'm sure Mike Whitehead's going to be in much better condition than what we saw him on the television show. I mean, he is an MFS elite, you know, former Militech fighting system. That's what they used to call it. Now the guys all in Iowa call themselves the MFS elite because apparently Pat has opened up a bunch of affiliate schools and they want to kind of separate from it. But they're all in incredible shape. They're all in great shape. They're all great athletes, great wrestlers, and tough guys to work out with. So I don't think we're going to have a conditioning problem out of Mike Whitehead tonight.
Well, Mike Whitehead is almost past the guard on a couple of occasions, but a good job done by Jardine to keep that, look at it, still keep that right leg at least intact so he can't pass and get a mount.
Yeah, that is what Tate said about him. He said he had a really excellent guard, very difficult to pass, good butterfly sweeps, and very good at standing up. You should see it right here. He's got an overhook on the right side. Mike Whitehead's putting weight on him. He's going to sweep him.
Mike applying great pressure up against the fence, which takes away some of the ability to work and swivel the hips for Keith Jardine.
Make it work, guys. Make it work.
Yeah, Mike White is doing a really good job of keeping him down. Keith rolling, trying to work it out.
Are you concerned at all with the way that Mike's weight has fluctuated? Do you look for all of a sudden all his energy to be sacked?
You know what? I would never sack against Bill Rush. That guy knows how to do it. I don't know how these guys dry themselves out like that. I don't understand it, but they do it. I mean, it can't be healthy. I mean, it's a tremendous amount of weight we're talking about losing. Most of it's water.
Make it work, guys. Make it work.
Replenish the electrolytes, apparently, and you do it properly, you can perform at least close to your optimum fighting
level. Well, a good job done here in the first round by Mike Whitehead. He really went all around the circles of his teammates and extended teammates to prepare this fight. Salt Lake City with Jeremy Horn, Cincinnati with Rich Franklin and George Giselle. There and then Iowa with the Milicic team, and back up to his feet again is Keith Jardine.
Don't hold his shorts.
Good job by Keith Jardine standing up here. Mike Whitehead expending a whole lot of energy, and it's really not working out for him. He hasn't been able to do any damage to Keith on the ground. He hasn't been able to pass his guard, and Keith's been able to stand up. Nice knee in there by Whitehead.
Again, Tim Sylvia always talks about training with the greatest heavyweights in the sport, and Whitehead has those hands and the ability to throw, but Jardine doing a good job just kind of, you know, weathering the early Whitehead storm, if you will.
He's got an excellent 1-2, Keith Jardine. He's got a really good straight right hand. He really hurt Rashad really bad on the show with that. Did a good job with it also against Kerry Shaw.
And you know he's working ground skills in Albuquerque, especially with, although he's a smaller fighter, Diego Sanchez around.
Yeah, that is just a great camp. That's one of the best up-and-coming camps in all of MMA right now.
You know, and the camp really has said to us that they think that Keith Jardine hasn't shown his true potential, even in victory over Shaw. And remember, it was leg kicks that finally brought Shaw down. But even in that victory, they say he hasn't shown his full potential, Joe.
Well, you know, it takes a long time for a lot of guys to get over the octagon flurries. The early fights in the octagon is such a nerve-wracking experience.
The former bounty hunter, Keith Jardine. There's a price for victory tonight if he can explode through Mike Whitehead in the prison right now. Yep. Mike tried to go with a strike kick and caught another one. Jardine's hands look good right now. He's getting the better of the stand-up. Whitehead can't take the punch, though, I'll tell you what.
He's taking a good punch, but he's shying away from the shots. It looks like Jardine's imposing his will out a little bit in the stand-up.
And a good finish to round number one for the Dean of Mean, Keith Jardine.
All right, let's take a look at the first takedown. See Mike Whitehead pressing him up against the fence. Now here's a nice shot of a good right hand Keith Jardine landed.
He's looking, you know, for you to close the distance, and then close his eyes and swing the bomb. So get him to work on that. You know, close the distance a bit, wait for him to swing, and then back out again, then come back in. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's fine. Your stand-up's looking fine. On the ground, don't throw punching from like a half guard or his guard.
Get under position. Him,
get all the way past that. Then you'll have some time to punch. As it is, you're only getting off one.
Hey, gentlemen.
Very intelligent advice in the corners, especially from Jeremy Horn.
Jeremy Horn working diligently to get Mike prepared for this fight. The lovely Rochelle tells us it is round number two of this light heavyweight matchup.
Give me a towel.
A little moisture going to be scooped up in front of the blue corner. Pat Miletic shouting out some final instructions to Whitehead as they prepare for round number two. Here we go. You know, a lot of guys got pretty tight in the house, and Mike said, you know what, we saw each other the first couple of days, but we didn't, and not in a bad way, but we didn't hang out a ton in the house during the taping of the Ultimate Fighter 2.
It's got to be hard for a lot of those guys to become close friends, to go to war with each other in a cage.
How about in the first series when everybody was shocked around the world when all of a sudden they had teammates fighting teammates?
Yeah.
You build all that chemistry and that bonding, and right. Certainly you're right about that.
It is an individual sport. At the end of the line, it's always going to be you and some other guy in the cage. Everything else is just support.
Jardine's doing a nice job coming forward with those combinations.
Yeah, he's got a good straight left, straight right combination. A good 1-2. And he's a tall guy. Nice jab.
Mike's heavy-handed, but Mike does have to get inside a bit.
Well, he was unsuccessful in imposing his will in the first round with the takedowns. Jardine kept getting up and couldn't pass Jardine's guard. And standing up, it looks like Jardine has the advantage here.
And that's one thing we have heard so much about the striking of Mike Whitehead. But at least in the UFC, we have really yet to see it because he was so lethargic during the fight against Rashad during the taping of the show. So we would like to see it here tonight. Matt Hughes yelling for him to get to the knees, but yet the takedown worked successfully as well.
He's got him again. You see, Jardine's got him in guard. He's got those really good butterflies. Good control from the bottom, holding him down, not allowing Mike to get off anything. As long as he's in this position, he can elevate Mike's hips and move him around a little. Mike's not going to land too much. He might be able to catch him with a sneaky elbow or something like that. But look, you see, Keith Jardine's very adept at getting those legs back inside and retaining guard.
And in this position, he's not pinned up against the fence, which is, Joe, going to allow his hips much more flexibility and mobility.
Yeah, definitely. And you'll see if he does get close to that, he'll spin away from it. I mean, that's one of the things that all those guys work on. He's in a half guard now. Mike is trying to pass, but you see Keith is so good at getting his leg in there. There he goes again. Bang. Look at that. He's going for a heel hit. Spun out of it.
Good job done by Jardine as Whitehead unsuccessfully tried to pass the guard two or three different times in that exchange.
I'm very impressed with Keith Jardine here. And, you know, we also have to think there's a lot of pressure on Mike Whitehead here. Mike Whitehead was touted as, you know, being the top guy on Matt Hughes' team. And when it came time to fight, he didn't perform up to his potential. And so now he knows that he has to. Well, he let a lot of people down. That's a lot of pressure.
Right now, though, on the judges' scorecards, although Whitehead hasn't put a lot of punishment on Jardine on the ground, he has, though, controlled the action.
Not on the feet, definitely. Jardine is definitely controlled on the feet, and he's back up again. Mike Whitehead's been taking him down, but he hasn't been able to do anything once he gets him there. He hasn't been able to land any effective punches, and he hasn't even been able to pass Keith Jardine's guard.
Bloodied up above the left eye is Iron Mike Whitehead.
Iron Mike Whitehead is going to have to do something, and he's going to have to do something drastic.
Former real-life bounty hunter and bail bondsman in the state of California, two-sport star in high school wrestling, and an all-star football linebacker. And I would think you would imagine that Keith Jardine was a linebacker.
Big dude.
Yep. Whitehead, three-time All-American wrestler and an Abu Dhabi qualifier.
We also have to wonder whether or not Mike Whitehead is tired now from the weight loss. I mean,
that's what I asked you before.
Yeah, yep. We have to think about that now because he's looking a little lethargic. He's got to know that this is a really close fight. He's got to turn it on if he wants to ensure a victory, and he doesn't seem to be doing that. He seems to be kind of laying back, and when Jardine's pressing the action, he's moving away a little. See? That to me tells me that he doesn't feel like he can handle him standing up, or he doesn't feel like he has the conditioning to go after him and try to take him down.
Oh, good straight left. See, but Whitehead, as you talked about, and this is really a development and the realization that your fatigue is starting to set in, wasn't throwing combinations, Joe. He's one punching out.
Yeah, the realization that your fatigue is starting to set in is a sickening feeling. You know, especially after coming off of that fight with Rashad, you know, being touted as being the best guy on Matt's team, falling short, a lot of pressure on him.
Mike Whitehead had his head down there, and Jardine almost caught him with a knee, and Jardine trying to push the pace here at the end of round number two.
Jardine looks to be much the fresher fighter here. All right, let's take a look at the replays. You see a good left hook, right hand by Mike Whitehead, and a good counter by Keith Jardine. Right there, nice left hook by Whitehead. And a good little right hand from Keith Jardine.
Mike, everything you throw that seems to be the right hand. He's crawling and dropping his right hand.
Cut above Mike Whitehead's left eyebrow. Not too bad, not a bad cut. We've seen a lot worse.
Close your eyes if you want, but fucking swing that left hook at the end of everything. Let that left hook go. That's why you're winning this fight.
Let's go.
Do you agree with the assessment in the corner of Jardine that he's winning this fight?
Yes, I think he's definitely winning it. He's definitely won the second round, and I think the first round was pretty close. You could have given it to him, but I think he definitely won the second round. He has a big advantage in the stand-up so far from where I see it.
Bring it on, come on!
Randy Couture watching in the locker room.
This is do or die for Mike Whitehead. This is the third round. So far, he's been able to get Keith Jardine down, but not do anything to him. On his feet, Keith Jardine has been winning the stand-up battle.
Now, Whitehead's got to try to do something differently here, especially Joe, if the judges agree with Jardine's corner in your assessment. It looks like he is starting to swing a little bit more for the fences. Uh-oh, good kick. And now Mike Whitehead driving forward on Jardine, but Jardine seemed to handle it very well.
Yeah. Good combination by Whitehead. Jardine just looked over at his corner and smiled because he stuck his tongue out because he's reaching for a Kimura on Mike Whitehead's left arm. If he gets that and Mike Whitehead can't get this takedown, Keith is going to drop down and he's going to shove his left leg in between Mike's legs and try to sweep him with the Kimura. He doesn't have it fully locked in, I see, because he's punching with his other arm. Right, so. Parisian is fantastic at that. It's one of his signature moves.
Now Mike is really, at least it seems, trying to push up the pace and accelerate his attacks here.
Nice right hand by Keith Jardine. Mike's got to realize he's got to do something. He hasn't been doing any damage in this round or the last one.
Good straight kick a moment ago by Jardine. Jardine seems very comfortable on his feet.
Yeah, he definitely does. Looks much improved. He looks better than he looked in the Kerry Shaw fight.
And that's what his camp talked about, him saying still we haven't seen his potential. Looking out to take a page out of teammate Matt Hughes' book. Didn't get the big slam, but nonetheless gets Jardine back down to the mat.
Good takedown by Whitehead, but again, he's stuck at Keith Jardine's guard. So even though he is on top, and he did take him down, he's not doing anything with it. Keith Jardine has been pounding him from the bottom. He's got a good butterfly guard in place. He's in the half
make
guard right now,
there,
but Keith
work.
Has got really flexible legs. Watch how he gets his leg underneath him, gets an overhook or an underhook, either one, and then stands up. He's got to be careful of the guillotine while he does this, though. Mike Whitehead has his right arm wrapped around Keith's neck.
Watch your head down there. He's still
and he's
got to
be careful that Mike doesn't put him in a guillotine. Nice knee by Mike Whitehead. He's allowed to knee as long as two hands are above the ground. It's when one hand goes down or both hands are down that he's not allowed to.
And that's what Steve Mazzagatti yelled,
yes.
Joe. He said, be careful there. He's still on the ground.
Yes.
And you saw Whitehead then step away from those knees.
Another nice right hand by Keith Jardine.
Well, octagon control has gone to Mike Whitehead here, and that is one of the judges' criteria.
Oh.
Left high kick, but Jardine able to again do the blocking. Begin with the left.
Keith Jardine seems very confident.
It's amazing after these guys win or lose survive the torture, if you will, of the Ultimate Fighter series. They seem to go back to their camps. We've seen a lot of the stars, if you will, of the reality shows, Joe. They seem to go back to their camps and improve drastically after that. And I think a lot of that is mental.
Sure. It's a huge learning experience just to be able to train with Matt Hughes and Rich Franklin. I mean, that's insane. I mean, that's a fantastic opportunity for a young fighter. Just that alone, being in the camp with all those different fighters, everyone's got the same goal, they're all training for it. Then to get through it and to learn from it, and then to have a fight on television and learn from that. I mean, Keith Jardine has, he's grown quite a bit.
And in addition, I think all of a sudden, you may have a guy who thinks he can be an Ultimate Fighter, who all of a sudden knows he can be an Ultimate
yes.
Fighter, and that changes everything every day.
Confidence is everything, and this game is 90% mental. Nice leg kick by Keith Jardine.
Under a minute remains in our third and final round. This light heavyweight matchup. And it is, at least at this point, on the way to the judges' scorecard.
Nice going for the takedown one more time. Keith doing a good job of stuffing it.
Based on effective striking, grappling, aggression, and octagon control is the criteria used by the judges.
Excellent takedown defense there by Keith Jardine. Mike Whitehead had a leg up, couldn't take him down.
They're toe-to-toe here with 15 seconds remaining. Combinations continue. Whitehead backing up. Jardine trying to finish with a flurry. Jardine has finished with the flurry in the first, second, and now here in the third round.
Excellent job by Keith Jardine.
This one will go to the judges' scorecards. Jardine looked very comfortable with his stand-up skills. Kickboxing is one of his specialties, working out of the camp that Diego Sanchez works out of in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And Jardine really was the man who was able to dominate with the right hand. And another thing that they always talk about is finish with a flurry, leave an indelible impression in the minds of the judges at the end of the round. And Jardine did that in round one, round two, and right here, as you witness, in round number three. And that may very well be the difference when we find out from Bruce Buffer who is victorious in this light heavyweight matchup of Ultimate Fighter 2 stars. Whitehead, again, well documented, about 285, 290 pounds just 10 weeks ago. Bruce Buffer has the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action, we go to the judges' scorecards. All three judges have scored this contest 29-28 for the winner by unanimous decision, Keith the Demon Man Jardine.
So it was close on all three judges' scorecards, but nonetheless, it is a unanimous decision. Here's Joe.
All right, I am here with Keith, the Dean of Mean Jardine. Congratulations. Now, Keith, this was a fight that a lot of people thought was going to be the final fight in the Ultimate Fighter finale. Have you been preparing yourself for this match for a while?
Yeah, I've been training for this for 8 weeks, but you know what? I'm sure you guys got a better show now because, man, Mike's got in shape. He's working a lot of stuff. He's a lot better fighter than he was then. And so am I, so.
Now, this is your first fight in the octagon at 205. Is that where you expect to see you in the future?
Yeah, man, I'll fight whatever, but 205, I'm real strong here, and I'm very comfortable here.
All right, excellent victory. Congratulations. Keith Jardine, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. I just say thanks God for the opportunity here. Say hi to my family back home. And most of all, my trainers, Mike Wimbledon and Greg Jackson. And I'll see you tonight at House of Blues, I guess, huh?
Keith Jardine, folks!
All right, the Dean of Mean, Keith Jardine, victorious here inside the octagon, relieved when the decision went in his favor. It's the Hammer House against an old UFC friend who has been punishing his opponents since his last octagon appearance. Hinkle and Munson, both dominators on the ground.
The Snowman Jeff Munson is a world champion submission grappler who trains with the American Top Team. Munson is most well known for his strength and his wrestling skills, but he has concentrated on his boxing skills lately, and he hopes to score a knockout tonight.
If we go to the ground, my jiu-jitsu comes into play. I think it's going to be short for him, but I'd like to make it an exciting fight. Let's keep it on the feet.
The Iron Lion, Brandon Lee Hinkle, is an NCAA Division II National Wrestling Champion and a U.S. National Freestyle All-American. Hinkle possesses heavy hands and loves to break up his opponent with vicious ground-and-pound tactics. Hinkle feels his athletic ability will carry him far in the heavyweight division.
I try to end all my fights. I don't like going to the decision. I don't know about him, but I'm going to throw some hard shots at him, and we'll see how it goes.
Coming up next, the Snowman, Jeff Munson, takes on the Iron Lion, Brandon Lee Hinkle.
And our tale of the tape is brought to you by Zion's Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. The big difference in this fight
is the sizable reach advantage of Brandon Lee Hinkle. But although he is so much taller than the compact Munson, he does only have a reach advantage of an inch and a half.
When the action begins, our referee in charge is Herb Dean.
Both men prior to this fight talked about how tough the other man is, and these are two tough heavyweights trying to establish themselves in the UFC. Brandon Lee Hinkle out of the Hammer House, and Jeff Munson from the American Top Team.
You ready to fight? You ready to fight? Come on, let's do it.
All right, let's see what happens. Let's see if they do slug it out here, Joe, or if this becomes a wrestling match between two very talented ground fighters.
Nice shot. Attempt for a takedown. Went right to guard. Jeff Munson. I don't know what kind of guard Munson has. He's used to being on top. It looks like he's sweeping for a... Looks like he's going for a half-guard sweep. He's got to hold a single leg. He's got him down. Brandon Lee Hinkle down. Again, remember, Jeff Munson, world Abu Dhabi heavyweight champion. That is the cream of the crop of submission grappling. It's the most elite competition in the world for submission grappling, and Jeff Munson is the king of the heavyweight.
And the interesting thing is that through his journeys in this business at age 33, he's been trained by Matt Hume. Matt Hume was his manager at one point. Then he spent some time with Randy Couture and Dan Henderson and the old Team Quest, and now he's with American Top Team. So he's been with three of the better camps in all of this business.
Yeah, I don't know why he moved around so much, but a lot of times when guys do move around, they get a more well-rounded skill set because they train with different guys with different strategies and, you know, different techniques that they use on a regular basis. But with American Top Team, you can't go wrong.
And he's got side control right here, trying to use the knees to the midsection, throw a little ground and pound, and connected with a right there.
He's doing a really good job of holding Brandon down, pressed up against the fence. He hasn't been able to land anything devastating yet, but he's definitely controlling the action. And Brandon is struggling. He's going to take his back.
I'll tell you what, the speed and explosiveness of a man 240 pounds or so in Jeff Munson is amazing, but now he's on his back in side control gained by Hinkle.
He was going for an arm there, lost it. Brandon did a good job of reversing him. Now Brandon's on top.
Now as a wrestler, this is where Brandon Lee Hinkle is most comfortable.
Yeah, definitely. Brandon doesn't want to be on his back. Brandon's got some really good ground and pound. We saw it against Sean Gannon.
Trying to utilize the same technique as we saw from Munson a moment ago. They do need to stay busy, or referee Herb Dean will stand them up. And we'll have a chance to see if they'll go toe-to-toe and trying to work that arm again. Good position here, Joe. What can he do with it, though?
Well, you know what? He's not the type of guy that's going to try to finish him with jiu-jitsu. He's going to try to finish him with ground pound. Good punch there. Nice right hand.
Oh, and a knee answered by Munson. Pushes his opponent back.
Monson's an animal. That guy is so strong.
I would venture to say he's as powerful a heavyweight as we have.
Yeah, he's incredibly powerful. I mean, look at the guy. That guy, that's a fire plug.
Hinkle trains with
Hinkle's looking for a guillotine.
Yep.
He dropped down. Good spin out of it by Munson. Munson using the underhook to stand. Grabbed a single. Bang. Brandon's back on his back again.
Mouthpiece out. Herb Dean pulls it aside.
That can't be good. Nope. Brandon spit his mouthpiece out. That means he's tired. That's not a good sign. Especially with a big gorilla like Jeff Munson on top of you.
This fight scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Good pace here and aggressiveness by Munson in the first round.
Jeff looks like he's securing that arm. He's dropping elbows, but he looks like he's holding on to Brandon's left arm. If he can step up and slide his leg over the chest or over the face, one of the legs is going to have to come over to secure him down. He let it go. It looked like he was holding onto that arm down, thinking about going for an armbar. He might still be doing that. He might just try to soften him up a little first.
Just a bit bloodied up is Brandon Lee Hinkle.
There's your chicken wing if you want it.
But the man controlling the majority of the action here in round one is Jeff Munson.
Jeff might be going for a darce here. He's got his arm, he's going for a choke here. He's got it.
He might have it.
He's got it locked up. That big guy on top, he's gonna tap.
Trying to get out of this.
He's not gonna get out of this, it doesn't look like. He might go to sleep. He's tapping.
And it's all over.
Very nice, he's out. He's out. He went to sleep.
Jeff Munson has submitted Brandon Lee Hinkle. He returns to the UFC and wins by submission.
Brandon's just now waking up, trying to figure out what happened. He was out. He tapped and he went out right afterwards. Beautiful submission by Jeff Munson.
He's trying to look to the big screen to see what happened.
Let's take a look at the replay. It looked like Munson got him in like sort of like a headlock and just crushed his neck. Like almost like a reverse guillotine from the top. Yep. And you see right there, Brandon's head dropped down. He was unconscious. Beautiful job.
Well, we talked about the power, and not just the power, but the submission skills of an Abu Dhabi champion in Jeff Munson.
Yeah, he is elite. I mean, he's one of the best in the world. He is the best heavyweight Abu Dhabi, the best heavyweight no-gi grappler in the world.
14th straight victory for Jeff Munson, and he is victorious in his return to the UFC. Here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Herb Dean has called a stop to this contest at 4 minutes 35 seconds of the very first round. For the winner by knockout due to an arm choke, the Snowman, Jeff Munson.
So the Snowman gets the victory, and here is Joe.
All right, I'm here with the Snowman. Jeff, congratulations. Abu Dhabi world champion, now back in the UFC. How do you feel?
I feel great. Brandon's a tough competitor. I knew he was going to come out hard, and I knew it was going to be a tough match, and I just want to give my hats off to him. It was a great fight.
All right, let's take a look at the replay and take a look at the submission and talk us through this here.
Well, I had him here, and I knew he was in trouble, but yeah, this last kind of pull right there where I thought he might get out, but I just held on tight and that was it. So I didn't want to give him another chance. So
I think you actually put him to sleep.
Yeah, it's a tough move to get out of.
All right, well, fantastic job. Congratulations. We look forward to seeing more of you in the heavyweight division.
Thank you. Jiu-Jitsu.
Jeff Munson, folks.
Yeah, Jiu-Jitsu 101 for Jeff Munson. The Snowman returns and returns with a decisive victory over Brandon Lee Hinkle. The submission with the arm choke. And I'll tell you what, this man may very well be back to stay. Suffice to say, we anticipate a slugfest. His nickname is the Headhunter, and his opponent loves, well, as well, to swing for the fences.
Gilbert El Peligroso Aldana is 5-0 with all of his victories coming by knockout. Aldana won his first mixed martial arts fight with a 3-second knockout. The heavy-handed half-Mexican, half-Guelmanian slugger has the ability to knock out opponents standing or on the ground. After dominating in smaller competitions, Aldana feels he is ready to make his UFC debut.
I've won all my fights by knockout. I got a lot of power, so if I connect, he's gonna get knocked out.
Mexican knockout artist Paul the Headhunter Buentello made an impressive UFC debut, knocking out Justin Eilers at UFC 51. While he is most well known for his explosive stand-up skills, Paul has worked hard on becoming a well-rounded fighter, as he displayed in his submission win over Kevin Jordan at UFC 53. At UFC 55, Paul got a shot at UFC World Heavyweight Champion Andre Arlovsky. Buentello landed a couple of punches before getting caught with a huge right hand that ended the fight. Now, Buentello looks to work his way back up the heavyweight ranking.
We're set to bang. I mean, he's a brawler, and I'm a brawler, so I'm gonna stand right there in front of him. You know, I'm not gonna take him down. I'm gonna stand and bang.
Coming up next, Gilbert El Peligroso Aldana takes on Paul the Headhunter Buentello.
Our Tale of the Tape brought to you by Zion's Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. 4 years, the elder, the American Buentello. He is fighting Gilbert Aldana, who is from Phoenix, Arizona. And the reach advantage is 2 inches for Buentello.
When the action begins, our referee in charge of the octagon is Big John McCarthy.
So Big John set to get this heavyweight matchup started. The beautiful Amber tells us we are set for round number one. Buentello.
All right, gentlemen, here we go, here we go. Are you ready? You ready? Let's get it on!
And we are underway. Quickly out to take the center of the ring, Aldana. Spinning back kick attempted by Buentello.
Yeah, that's weird to open up with that. Aldana, nice knee, nice punches.
Man, Aldana went for the body early. Look at him with a furious pace.
He got an uppercut. Big right.
The uppercut is known to be a big weapon for Buentello. He's got great uppercuts.
Aldana recovered, though. Aldana recovered, and he's banging back.
No hesitation to begin this one.
He was rocked, and he came back very quickly. Very good composure for a guy with only 5 fights. Nice uppercut by Aldana. Good body shots.
That's the one thing we are waiting to see more of, especially from the big guys, Joe. Uppercuts and body shots. Well, and already we've seen a lot from both men.
Yeah, Paul's very well versed. I mean, nice head kick.
Yeah, he caught him. Now the uppercut and a knee.
A nice knee.
Good combinations by Buentello. Another knee. Aldana is down. Can Buentello finish this quickly?
We saw him recover very fast standing up. Let's see if he can get out of this situation and clear his head.
He caught him with that left leg kick.
He looks really rocked.
More.
Really wobbly.
And more combinations by Paul Buentello. Aldana's gassed.
He looks tired and wobbly. He's been rocked. He's been hit with some big punches. And a big kick to the face.
Oh, spinning back kick again. And swinging with the uppercut for the fences. It's the headhunter.
Gilbert looks very tired.
If you're Buentello, do you try to close it out here?
Well, it's only 3 minutes and 20 seconds into the fight. That's a long time when you're that tired. Paul's a very experienced guy. I think he's going to pick his shots and wait for Gilbert to get more tired. It's not like he's going to feel better in a couple of minutes.
Not if he keeps getting hit.
Yeah, I mean, the first round, to be gassed like that 2 minutes into the fight, not a good sign for Gilbert. But it was a furious pace.
Now, I love the way that Gilbert came out and came out with aggression. You can see why he had totaled under 4 total minutes in 5 fights in Rage in the Cage and winning their super heavyweight title.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of guys going to be able to withstand that storm.
Decent combination there, Joe, pardon me.
Yeah, Paul Buentello is a very experienced fighter. That's why he's able to keep it together. And Gilbert, win or lose or draw, is going to gain immeasurable experience from this fight.
Well, I'll tell you what, everybody loves a guy who brings it. And win or lose, as you said, Gilbert Aldana brought it early.
Absolutely.
All right, Ed, we have now reached the midway point of round one. Fight is scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds at this pace. There's no way we will get that far. But you never know. Things have changed drastically before.
That's one of the hallmarks of a... Oh, again,
connects with the
high
left
kick.
Yeah. Great job by Buentello.
One of the biggest skills to learn in being a professional fighter is how to conserve your energy and how to pace the fight.
And now big down right hand goes by Buentello.
It looked more like a slip than the actual punch to put that down. Look at Paul rotating for an armbar.
Close guard. Now this will allow Aldana to try to catch some of his win back. He's got to stay busy on the ground, though, or John McCarthy will stand both fighters right back up.
I mean, it looks like he's using this right now as a chance to get his win back.
And that would be the thing you would suggest to him, isn't it, Joe?
Yeah, well, he's in a nice spot where he's not in too much danger. But he's just got to stay busy enough so that Big John doesn't stand him up at this point. He's got his back. Look at that. He passed, and he got his back. Now what he needs to do here is get the over-under and get the hooks in. He let it slip.
They're both going to be
up. Fatigue. And if he goes to the guillotine, he's going to get... Okay, it slipped out.
Good nice knee to the midsection. Answered, though, by Aldana.
Yeah, but Aldana went right to the family jewels.
Under a minute remains. Buentello's going to try to work towards another nasty uppercut.
Aldana is tough, man.
That's a third time. Oh, he tried the spinning back fist a la Shoney Carter after the spinning back kick. The nasty uppercut again. Trying to tee off.
Can't take too many of those.
No, one of them's going to connect. And again, the uppercut.
A lot of blood.
Combination.
It's bleeding badly. I don't know where it's coming from, but it's all over his face and chest. Again.
Oh, the uppercut's outstanding here by Buentello. Now with the left.
With both sides.
And the right.
And Gilbert's not offering any opposition. It looks like his cheek, his nose. He might be cut in a couple spots.
And again. Wow. Round one is complete. Bloodied up Gilbert Aldana. And listen to the reaction of the crowd here at the Mandalay Bay Event Center.
All right, let's take a look at some of the action from that round. Beautiful uppercuts by Paul Buentello. This is the end of the round where Gilbert was in some big trouble. And let's take a look at that high kick earlier. Bang, right on the jaw. Just the foot, not the shin. Wasn't the most powerful striking area, but it did a good job. Landed right on the chin, rocked Gilbert. And by that time, he was already fatigued. Great pace, very furious first round, but Gilbert took a lot of punishment.
How much more can he take?
He's a tough guy, man. I don't know, you know? I mean, he looks like he's recovered in that minute. Well, he's still a little wobbly.
This one may be heavy. This one may not last much longer if Buentello goes to finish it.
Well, now Buentello, I think we're going to see him pick him apart. Because Paul's had his minute rest. He looks real fresh. He's bouncing, and Gilbert still looks very tired. His nose is bleeding steadily, maybe broken.
As a fighter, Joe, is there any worse feeling than, caught him with a spinning back kick that time. Fourth time a charm for Buentello. Is there a more demoralizing and frightening feeling than knowing that you're fatigued and your opponent is fresh and coming at you with four guns a-blazing?
It's pretty horrifying, and you know, as much time as you put in the gym, when you get that big adrenaline dump when you get into the octagon, even guys who are in great shape gas out really early. We've seen it with guys before, many fighters who were very highly touted. You see their first octagon appearance, and they have a really hard time breathing. Rich Crunkleton's an excellent example of that.
Oh, he connects again with an uppercut.
Gilbert's heart, though. He's still swinging.
He sure does.
He caught Buentello with a little right hand in there himself. I mean, the guy looks completely exhausted, and yet somehow he gets the energy up to throw some bombs.
Oh, a knee now. This one's not the end. This is even closer than the beginning, I think.
But. Nice inside leg kick for a sweep by Paul. Now we're going to see some ground and pound, and this, I think, is going to be the end.
Well, Big John McCarthy's right there.
Real close look at him. Paul's going to secure that right arm inside, in between his legs. That's what he's trying to do. Matt is the position that Matt Hughes used. He's going for the Americana.
He's let it go. You know what? If an opponent cannot intelligently defend himself, then the referee will stop the fight.
He's going for an armbar.
Oh. He's just pounding away.
He stepped up for that armbar.
Aldana's gas tank is empty. About 6 minutes into this contest. And it seems inevitably only a matter of time.
Come on, baby, let's go.
I'll tell you what, if you're Gilbert Aldana, I don't know if you want to stand back up.
Come on, Gilbert.
He's got that Americana again. He keeps letting it go, though. Gilbert is just battered. It looks like he's looking for a submission. I mean, it looks like he could finish the fight by punching him, pounding him out if he wanted to. But I think he might want to finish with a submission.
Well, this fight has lasted already longer than Aldana's entire MMA career in Rage in the Cage. As it lasted well over 3 minutes and 43 seconds. It's going to end any second now. It's all over.
It's
all over. Paul Buentello totally dominates Gilbert Aldana. And back to his winning ways is the headhunter.
Paul Buentello, too much experience, too much skill, too much composure. Gilbert Aldana, very tough guy, very game guy, but just overwhelmed tonight.
So again, the momentum will build for Paul Buentello, the headhunter. And we have talked about him in the past
being able to utilize the nasty uppercuts. And we saw him tag Aldana over and over and over with pinpoint strikes, the most violent which seemed to be the uppercuts, which bloodied up Gilbert Aldana in his UFC debut. And the conditioning for Buentello seemed to be excellent as well.
I'm trying.
Good job, baby.
Thank you, sir.
Great job.
Come on, hurry up. Yeah.
Bruce Buffer has the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee John McCarthy has called a stop to this contest at 2 minutes 27 seconds of round number 2 for the winner by TKO, Paul the Headhunter Buentello.
Joe Rogan with the victor, the Headhunter, Paul Buentello.
All right, I'm here with Paul. Paul, congratulations. Fantastic victory. In the beginning, he really took it to you. Were you hurt at all in the beginning, in the early first?
No, it was no Olasky hit. But, you know, I'm going to tell you the fans, I didn't go anywhere after that loss, 55. I'm here, baby. I'm here. All right. I want to say one thing. See if I got some fans out here. You ready? Here we go. Don't fear me. Come on, baby. Hey, you know, don't fear me. Fear the consequences, baby. You know, I've been training hard. I'm not looking to call anybody out. I just want to fight. I want to make it simple for all the fans. Put it in front of me. I'll bring it. Guaranteed.
All right, Paul, let's talk us through the end of the fight here. This is the replay. Look up at the board.
You know, I got to give it to Gilbert. He has a lot of heart. I asked him, I said, hey, give up, brother. I'm not going to stop. He goes, neither am I. Got a lot of heart. It's a Mexican for you. Viva la raza, que no cabrón.
All right, Paul, what's next now? You had the shot against Arlovsky. Do you feel that you've improved since then? Do you feel that you want a rematch? Like, what's going through your mind right now?
You know, I'm not going to call him out. I'm not going to call the champ out. He's a champ. I will deserve my shot. Again, I will deserve it. And I'll prove to the fans, baby, I'm not going nowhere. My house.
We look forward to seeing you earn it. Paul Buentello, ladies and gentlemen.
A very vocal Paul Buentello. And it was well documented that he went right back to the gym, did not hang his head after being knocked out by Andre Arlovsky. And you can see that Buentello is back, and back with a vengeance. You know, if this fight hits the canvas, Elvis may leave the building a winner. His opponent from Rome, he now lives in Rio, and he has exceptional hands.
Australia's king of rock and rumble, Elvis Sinisek, is known for his slick jiu-jitsu skills. Elvis shocked the world in his UFC debut, submitting number one light heavyweight contender Jeremy Horn with a triangle armbar in the first round. The King returned at UFC 55, where he engaged in an exciting war with Forrest Griffin. Sinisek hurt Griffin early, but Forrest would rally back to win by TKO in 3 minutes and 22 seconds of the first round. Sinisek showed that his striking can be as dangerous as his submissions, and he hopes to put those skills together to pull off a victory tonight.
Whatever opportunity he provides for me, I'll take advantage of, and I'm going to win the match.
Alessio Legionarius Sakara is an Italian boxer who recently held the IBF Junior World Championship. Sakara was looking impressive in his debut at UFC 55 against Ron Faircloth until the fight had to be stopped in the second round when Faircloth landed a devastating low blow that Sakara could not recover from. The fight was ruled a no contest. Sakara wants to put the disappointment of his debut out of his mind and concentrate on getting his first UFC victory. Coming up next, the King of Rock and Rumble, Elvis Sinisek, takes on Alessio Legionarius Sakara.
Our tale of the tape brought to you by Zions Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. The Australian against the Italian.
And the Australian is 10 years older and does have a reach advantage. The one thing to watch with Elvis, he has very long legs. That's how he caught Jeremy Horn. If it goes to the mat, that may make a difference.
When the action begins, our referee in charge of the octagon is Steve Mazzagatti.
Steve Mazzagatti, our referee, Elvis Sinisek. Against Alessio Sicara, light heavyweight matchup here from Mandalay Bay.
All right, here we go. You ready? You ready? Bring it on, come on!
All right, let's see if Elvis does go for the early takedown.
Alessio immediately charges forward. Nice body shot. Damn, nice body shot.
This is going to try to control any way he can, isn't he, Joe? You can already see the boxing skills in just the first 15 seconds, the hands of Alessio Sicara.
He's got double underhooks on Elvis.
Elvis, a very experienced mixed martial artist, as you talked about that.
And we've talked about Alessio's hands, but we haven't talked about his ground game, which is supposed to be very good as well. We just haven't had a chance to see it yet. And there we go! Beautiful takedown! And again, Elvis Sinisek, very dangerous from his back. Elvis is in half guard right now. Alessio's trying to pass. Look for Elvis to try to sweep.
Well, Elvis is a black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Chato Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And he has amazing submission ability. So one place he is not totally uncomfortable is on his back with his opponent in the closed guard.
Now he's got an excellent guard. Like you said, he submitted Jeremy Horn for his guard. He's got to be careful here.
Multiple Australian Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu champion. We talked about him when he was in the UFC years ago. Former IT support officer said he was a computer geek working the phones. A little IT support. He's happened to be one of the toughest guys working the phones that you've ever seen.
Stay busy. Keep busy. Keep busy.
Alessio is just trying to throw punches from the guard. It's not the best place to punch. You can land some shots, but you're not going to get effective leverage. And Elvis is doing a good job of kind of minimizing any damage that Alessio can inflict here.
Okay, stop!
All right, here we go. We're going to stand it up and back to the feet.
We had a second of time.
Yeah, Elvis is coming. Shot. Yeah, and caught a left too.
His hands are down, and his head is straight up, and he's back again.
Well, you know what? I wonder for a second, though, if Sicara feels that he has so much control on the hands, why the takedowns of Elvis Sinisek?
Maybe he just wants to prove his ground game. I mean, who knows? Maybe he thinks that he can just get him on his back, and when Elvis is going for submission, he can pound him out, which is what he's trying to do here.
Now, Sicara, Legionarius, his nickname. Very, very well-trained fighter. And becoming more of a mixed martial artist every day.
He's saying don't come down at the point of the elbow.
Yep, you can't come down with the point of the elbow to the top of the head.
One point.
So they take a point away from Sicara.
No warning, just one point.
Yep, no worries. You know what, I hope Sicara understands totally there.
You see Elvis's head, it's still straight up in the air.
Oh, he caught him. Bang. He got rocked and he got rocked again. Oh, Sicara's hands are outstanding. Yeah. And he's taking Elvis down at will, but to that point though, Joe, I don't know that Elvis really minds going down
Elvis
to his
jumped
back.
To guard there.
Yeah, there you go, exactly. Yep.
He went for the double overhooks and he jumped to guard. He knows he can't stand with this guy. This is real bad. Elvis, like we said before, he stands up. He's got good strikes, but he stands up where his head is straight up in the air. He doesn't tuck his chin. He doesn't put his shoulders up. He doesn't keep his hands up high and protect himself. And against a guy like Alessio Sicara, that just spells doom.
I'll tell you what, you may see Elvis, you know, skinny guy, 6'3", doesn't look to have a lot of girth to him, and walking down the street think he's not tough, but I'll tell you what, he was punished by Tito Ortiz, and I remember seeing him in London after he lost to Babalu, and he went the distance in that fight and was completely demolished. So there'll really have to be a lot of punishment for Sicara to get Elvis to tap out. He's a tough cat.
Yes, but he has already suffered a lot of punishment. I mean,
who knows
how wobbly he is right now, even just lying on his back.
Stay busy,
if he stands up after this, we'll get a good shot of it.
see how hurt he really is. It's one of the things, if you're really rocked and wobbly and you just grab a guy and pull guard, you know, you can kind of hang on even though your head's not clear. As long as the guy doesn't land too many bombs from the top, you can recover.
Stand up, guys. Stay busy.
Yeah, Elvis does not want to hear it when I stand you up.
You
what he should be doing
right.
is throwing those legs up, try to get something. Go for the rubber guard. Pull his leg. There he goes. It looked like he was going for an omoplata there, but very loose and open.
And a great pace being displayed by Sakara.
He's getting pelted
yeah,
here.
Yeah, he's bloodied up big time now. I don't know if he caught him in the head. Yeah, we're going to stop
it. Has a history of that. He's got a history of being cut. He's cut by Evan Tanner. He's cut by Tito Ortiz.
Yeah, this might be
oh,
it.
Oh, that's bad.
Yep. Yeah, this might be it. It looks like his forehead. We're going to bring the doctor in. He catch him with an elbow, Joe.
It looks like he caught him with a lot of different things. That Alessio Sakara is danger.
He can go.
He
doctor
can go.
Says he can go.
Good, excellent. It's just a cut on the top of the forehead.
Tell you, like I said, Elvis will try to take all he can.
But now they're standing up again.
You ready?
Yeah.
You ready? Oh, wait.
Here we go again.
Lay down.
They're going to put him back in the same position.
Nice.
Which again, excellent. We talked about is an excellent rule, and it somewhat benefits Elvis, one might think.
Oh, 100% benefits Elvis. We call that the Dwayne Ludwig rule. That rule was instituted after Dwayne Ludwig and Genki Sudo had a phenomenal bout, but Dwayne was cut, and because of that cut, they made those guys stand up again, and Dwayne wound up winning the decision, and there was a huge debate about it on the internet. Let's take a look at the replay. Some fantastic hands from Alessio Sakara. This is from the ground. Let's take a second look here. This might be the punch that cut him. It was a combination punch and elbow. It doesn't look like that's the one that cut him, though. The best hand techniques that Alessio displayed were actually the beginning of the round and the stand-up portion of it. But either way, very dominant first round for Alessio Sakara. I don't know, that sounds like they're summoning a demon.
Seconds out, let's go!
I don't know, but I think they said do exactly what you've been doing.
That sounds like something out of an Exorcist movie.
You know, Elvis trying to stay so relaxed, smile on his face, and you know, I'll tell you what, he is an upbeat guy and a pleasure to talk to and visit with.
Yeah, he's a great guy. Yeah. I hate to see him getting battered. And you look at him smile. He's like, hey, let's keep doing this.
Yep.
But you notice, head is straight up in the air. You see that? Yep. And soon he's going to get caught with a counter.
Sakara's just quick hands. It's the speed that's beating him.
It's amazing Sakara has decided to take this fight to the ground because that's the only shot that Elvis has to win. If standing up, Sakara has to do is just back away, and every time Elvis tries to take him down or jump the guard, back away, and then continue the stand-up exchange.
I think I asked you why you did that in the first round.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I mean, I thought maybe he was just trying to show that his, you know, that he has a good ground game, and the first throw that he, you know, put Elvis down with was beautiful. Got double underhooks, slammed his body down, but he's not even trying to pass, which is the confusing thing. He's content to stay in Elvis's guard and just throw punches with minimal leverage. He's an excellent striker, so, you know, even a small short punch from a guy like that can cause a lot of damage, as you see right there. But he would be so much better if he could just stand up, get a knee between those two legs, pass the guard, get to a dominant position, and then finish this fight. Or get out of that position and stand up and force Elvis into his world.
Elvis just trying to do anything he can in survival mode here, bloodied up. The blood matching his dyed hair coming in.
Maybe he knew that.
Yeah, he might have. I'll tell you what.
He anticipated.
That's a bad way to decide to get your hair red because you think you're going to bleed into it.
Well, it is a UFC fight. Oh, yes, no, there we go. Now Alessio's starting to pass. Very nice. He's in half guard now, and it looks like he's going for a head and arm choke. It's just basically going for it. Right here, he's basically just got an over-under. He's got head and arm control.
Would you be extremely surprised if he was actually able to submit someone with a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt?
No, well, he's got excellent Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills, too. You saw from that beautiful pass, really nice guard pass here. So he's in Elvis's side now. Oh, and Elvis puts him right back to full guard. Ugh, all that work for nothing. And that's why a lot of wrestlers, like, that's the Mark Kerr strategy. The Mark Kerr strategy. Oh, he's finishing it right here.
Elvis is in big trouble again.
What I was saying was that it was always Mark Kerr's strategy to stay in the guard because it's so much energy to try to pass the guard.
Right.
And you saw he used up all that energy, but he looks like he's still fresh. He can do so much more damage from outside of that position. But he's holding on to Elvis's hand and punching him at the same time. Elvis is getting battered.
This reminds me so much of the fight against Babalu.
Yeah, very similar.
In London at the Royal Albert Hall. Back at UFC 37, July of 2002.
And Elvis isn't doing anything to stop this. He's got to figure out a way to keep Alessio's posture down. He's got to keep it. It looks like Steve Mazzagatti's going to. Oh, he's just standing the fight
up.
I thought he was going to bring in the doctor.
No, he's going to stand it up, and this could be danger right here. This could mark the end. Caught him again with good combinations.
He's rocked.
Yep, Elvis is rocked again.
Elvis, it's showing tremendous poise. And the ability to take a punch.
You know what? Takara kind of just looked at the bloodied face of his opponent, almost in disbelief, like, wow, can I finish this? Yeah, he's telling him to watch the headbutts, unintentional as it may be. Unintentional, pardon me. You got to watch the head there. But Takara really doing a nice job of keeping busy.
Yeah, I'm very impressed with him. He's completely dominating a world-class fighter here. Elvis is a very tough guy. Completely dominating on his feet and just smashing him on the ground. The only thing Elvis has been able to do so far is just reclaim guard. That's the only advantage in position he's ever been able to achieve. He hasn't been able to stand up. He hasn't been able to even attempt a submission. And he hasn't been able to do any damage whatsoever on the feet. See, look at that. That was really open and loose. That's not the Elvis that I know. He's tired and he's battered right now. Elvis is just trying to hold on to his wrists and stop those punches from coming down, but that's not the most effective way to do it. He's got to figure out a way to either get his legs up, grab a hold of one of his legs, and pull down on Alessio's neck, which is what they call, Eddie Bravo calls the rubber guard.
They're going to stand him up again, and let's see if the combination finishes Elvis this time.
Elvis, again, is just looking to just grab and pull guard. Nice leg kick by Elvis.
Good hands by Sakara. Good kicks, though. Elvis is known for having good kicks.
See, he got the double overhooks again. Yeah, he let him take him down there. So Elvis has got to hold. He's got to hold his head down and keep it down. Keep him from raising up. If Alessio can get posture, if he can get up, then he can throw punches.
So the second round is in the books, and it has been all Alessio Sakara.
Let's take a look at some of the action. Inside leg kick by Elvis, and then a counter, beautiful counter. Left, right, goes to the double underhooks, and then just decides to take him to the ground. And Elvis just taking a pounding here. You see his eyes roll back, and then he recovers. I mean, a battering. Doing his best just to stay in this fight at this point.
Well, you know what? We talked so much the night in London about the heart of Elvis Sinisek because of the punishment he took from Babalu. And similarly, we talked about the punishment that Tito put upon him. And this fight could be a carbon copy of that.
Yeah, you could definitely say that. Unfortunately for Elvis Sinisek. And still, big, huge smile on his face. What a great guy.
Well, I'll tell you what. I would love to see him try to reverse it and make it a little bit closer for just the sport itself, and because he's such a good sport. But I don't know how he's going to be able to do it, Joe.
Yeah, he's going to see him pull guard again. There.
Absolutely. I mean, continuously we're seeing the same things from Sakara in the maroon and gold. He's been at the top the whole time, and this is well on its way to being a definitively unanimous decision.
Yeah, Elvis just isn't doing anything. When he gets him on his back, he's throwing some punches from the bottom. But those are ineffective. They're not going to stop anyone. What he's got to do, somehow or another, he's got to figure out a way to either sweep him or try to get some sort of a submission. It's very difficult to sweep a guy when you're in full guard like that either. He's either got to go to butterfly guard or he's got to go to half guard. But he's got to do something different than he's doing right now because he's just taking a pound.
4 minutes remains in our third and final round. Talked about before,
Sakara transforming himself into a force in the mixed martial arts world. He was 11 years old when he started to train boxing. At 18, he started to train jiu-jitsu and mixed martial arts. So that's 6 years of training, as you alluded to before, Joe, in the bigger picture sport of mixed martial arts. He is very well-versed. Of course, fighting in Rio with great teammates is going to get you prepared to fight inside the UFC.
Yeah, he's training with Daryl Golar for his wrestling. I mean, he's down there with Antonio Nogueira, Minotauro, all those guys down in Brazil. So he's got some excellent training partners. But again, inexplicably, he just is content to stay in Elvis's guard. I mean, he is doing damage, but not the kind of damage he'd do on his feet. Blood all over the place coming off of Elvis. I mean, it's just every time Alessio punches him, you see a splatter.
I told you that Elvis wouldn't tap very easily, though, and we have seen that so far here.
Yeah, well, he's no joke. I mean, he's not going to tap out, but he's very ineffective in this fight. Steve Mazzagatti standing him up.
One big one may catch him. One big one may catch him, because Forrest Griffin did it 3.5 minutes into the first round. There it is. Two big ones may catch him. Two good left hooks by Alessio Sakara, and a little bit more force on that most recent takedown.
Yeah, it's still the same thing, though. I mean, he allows this to happen. And he gets stuck in this position, and we're in the same spot where he's just throwing. I mean, he's doing damage. Elvis's face is a mess. He's getting battered, but not nearly as much damage as he does in a stand-up position. Elvis has got to do something. He's got 2 minutes left. It's the last round. He's got to throw up a triangle, do something, pull the head down, try to stand up, and maybe get some sort of a sweep, anything.
Come on, stay busy, stay busy.
But lying here in the guard, getting punched in the face, I mean, he's obviously exhausted. He's taken a tremendous beating. A lot of heavy blows. It's hard to watch Elvis take a beating.
It is hard to watch, you know. It's hard to watch anybody take a beating because, you know, I would say 95% of the guys that we have in this sport are all great guys.
Yeah.
You know what? They believe in the martial arts theory of respect and understand this is competition.
There you go again.
I've used the analogy before, Joe. It's like the tough guys in the National Hockey League. You'd think they'd be the guys who you wouldn't want to deal with, but they're the nicest guys.
Elvis
goes right back down. He's going to get saved by the bell, literally, but he's not going to get the victory because this is going to do it here. Yeah. Now, you know what? There's no reason right now for the crowd to boo a man who has survived the punishment of what Elvis has survived here for 15 minutes.
They want blood.
Yeah,
no matter what, they want blood. They're here to be entertained.
Well, last time I checked, they're getting a little bit.
Yeah, they're getting a lot of it.
So Alessio Sakara is going to turn some more heads with this very, very impressive unanimous decision victory over Elvis Sinisic. Well, and really, we've only seen flashes in the hands. Bing, 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 he's loaded it up, but he didn't get to finish him because of a combination of the takedowns that Alessio had and Elvis, as you said, Joe, pulling guard.
Elvis looking for a last-minute leg lock.
Too slippery with all the blood. Too slippery with all the blood.
How about Alessio Sakara versus Chuck Liddell? How much would you like to see that?
Don't hate it. I think Bob will lose his line, too.
Absolutely.
Don't hate it at all.
Excellent sportsmanship.
I'll tell you what. Yeah, that's just class, man. Look at that. That is just class. That is what this sport is about. The native of Rome, Italy, fighting out of Rio de Janeiro. And all giving great congratulations and respect to an opponent who he battered for 15 total minutes.
All right, let's take a look at some of the action from that round. The hands of Alessio Sakara. Elvis throws a leg kick, left hook he catches, another left hook. I mean, just a testimony to Elvis's heart that he was able to stand this for 3 rounds.
So it will be a unanimous decision victory for none other than Alessio Sicara. Extremely impressive here tonight at the Mandalay Bay Event Center.
If it's not a unanimous decision, someone's blind.
Yeah, you got that right. And he really didn't get rocked at all. He took very little, if any, punishment at all from Elvis Sinisic. The king of rock and rumble was rocked and rumbled, unfortunately, for he and his teammates here this evening.
Excellent showing for Alessio.
All right, official decision will not be a surprise from Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action, we go to the judges' scorecards. Abe Bilardo scores the bout 29-25. Cecil People scores the bout 29-26. And Jeff Mullen scores the bout 29-26. For the winner by unanimous decision, Alessio Legionarios Sicara.
So really the only point he lost was the point in which he was penalized for. He is truly the kid from the streets of Stockton who feels destined someday to wear the UFC belt. Nick Diaz tonight will be tested by the Diesel, who was recently derailed by a world champion.
Joe Diesel Riggs is a heavy-handed striker who can deal out punishment standing or on the ground. Riggs, a former heavyweight, is known for his strength and ability to deliver a massive amount of damage in a very short time. After dropping from heavyweight to middleweight, Riggs made his welterweight debut, becoming the first man to ever finish tough veteran Chris Lytle at UFC 55. When contender Carl Parisian pulled out of his championship match with Matt Hughes due to injury, Riggs accepted the fight on short notice. Riggs was submitted by the champ, but the young fighter sees it as a learning experience and feels it is only a matter of time before he earns another shot at the title.
I won't lose this fight. I can't lose this fight. I'm sure Nick feels the same way.
Nick Diaz is a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu brown belt who trains under Cesar Gracie. Diaz made a big impression quickly in the UFC with a submission win over Jeremy Jackson and a knockout win over ruthless Robbie Lawler. He has also scored impressive first-round TKOs of Drew Bickett and Pancrase fighter Koji Oishi. At only 22 years of age, Diaz is considered to be one of the welterweight division's fastest rising stars. With his combination of excellent jiu-jitsu skills and potent striking, he is a threat wherever the fight takes place.
When I fight, I like being an exciting fighter. You know, I train hard, I want to fight hard. I'm going out there trying to kill.
Coming up next, Joe Diesel Riggs takes on Nick Diaz.
Tale of the Tape brought to you by Zayats. Both are youngsters. Definitive reach advantage for Nick Diaz, and he will not be afraid to use his reach advantage. Remember, he outstruck the massively talented striker Robbie Lawler inside the octagon right here back in April of 2004. Let's get officially started with the veteran voice of the octagon, Bruce Buffer.
And when the action begins, our referee in charge is Mario Yamasaki.
Diaz against Riggs in what has already been a healthy war of words.
Are you ready? Let's go!
And here we go. Riggs with a high kick.
And Diaz pressing the action.
Nick loves to press the action, and now he looks for an early shoot.
Good takedown defense by Riggs. Nick's rolling, trying to get an arm bar. Nick Diaz has an excellent guard.
That is the basis of his fighting skills. We have seen him become so much more, Joe, but that is the basis.
Yes.
Cesar Gracie, his trainer with Gil Castile, started with the Gracies at age 16, so 6 years and a brown belt in Gracie Jiu-Jitsu.
Yeah, he's an excellent Jiu-Jitsu fighter. And like we said, he's an excellent boxer as well. He's got several pro boxing bouts, and he's got really good hands.
Well, sometimes Nick Diaz will try to go strength against strength. And in this particular situation, that might be hands against hands with Joe Riggs. Fight is scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. All will be 3 5-minute rounds tonight, other than, as we mentioned earlier in our ways to win, the championship bout, our main event of the evening between the Iceman Chuck Liddell and the natural Randy Couture.
I'm surprised to see Nick Diaz pushing the action here.
Good combinations by Riggs.
Nice knee to the body, good uppercut inside as well.
They really love to work the hands now, present day in the Miletic camp, and he caught him with the right again. What an interesting scenario, too, for Riggs to gain the respect of the Miletic team during the loss to Matt Hughes and now training with Rich Franklin and Matt Hughes, champions at 185 and 170.
Well, he was training with those guys, with Jeremy Horn and all those guys down in Utah before the Matt Hughes fight. Matt Hughes was supposed to be fighting Carl Parisian. Carl Parisian had a leg injury, had to pull out of the fight. And when Joe Riggs took the fight, they made him leave camp. See you, dude. Have a good time. Not so good for Joe Riggs. Joe Riggs had a really hard time finding sparring partners. But now he is back. Oh, he got rocked!
Yeah, he did. Oh, my.
Joe Riggs got dropped there by Nick Diaz's right hand. Nick Diaz rolling for a Kimura. He's going to get a knee here.
Riggs is just trying to get back to his senses. Back to his feet. He got hit again.
Nick Diaz raised his hand, very confident here.
You know what? This looks a little bit like the Lawler fight with him swinging the arms around, and now we have ourselves a battle.
And
caught him with
talking.
A straight right.
Now he's talking to him, too. I mean, he can really frustrate guys with all that trash talk. Like I said, when he was fighting Drew Fickett, I was watching him, punching him. He was like, how do you like that, Drew?
Good combination back by the Diesel.
And again, we have to take into consideration the fact that Joe Diesel is 30 pounds heavier than he was at the weigh-ins. I mean, that is a tremendous amount of water to put back in your system and a tremendous amount of water to lose.
Up against the fence, 148 remains in round number one. Diaz has rocked Joe Riggs once already.
I mean, Nick Diaz looks to be the stronger fighter here, which is amazing if you look at their two bodies, because Joe Riggs looks quite a bit bigger.
Now, I'll tell you what, if you go body against body, Robbie Lawler looked bigger. Drew Fickett looked bigger.
Yeah, Nick Diaz is
Koji Oishi did not look bigger.
No.
But he was dropped real quickly by Nick Diaz. Diaz has been so vocal lately about being disregarded and disrespected at 170 pounds. The reality stars have passed him up, and he deserves his shot at Matt Hughes, but then he was derailed by Diego Sanchez, and right back to it, though, so far here against Joe Riggs, and Riggs with combinations and lands a right inside. Riggs seems to have his legs back now, Joe.
He does, but he's also got his mouth open, and it looks like he's breathing heavy, and Nick is still pressing the action.
Well, the one thing we've always seen is Nick Diaz always comes into the octagon in excellent condition.
Yeah, he's phenomenal shape.
Pulling guard is Joe Riggs.
Body punches inside by Nick Diaz.
And with the loss of Carlson Gracie here recently, as an extension of the Gracie family, you know Nick has felt that inside the camp, and that might be a little extra motivation to get a definitive victory for the Gracie camp, if you will, tonight.
Perhaps. That was a huge loss to the jiu-jitsu community. Carlson Gracie, one of the greatest jiu-jitsu fighters of all time, one of the founders of Valley Tudo as we know it.
Well, the founder of rebounding, if you will, during his NBA career, the round mound of rebound, Charles Barkley in the house tonight, and it was a good first round for Nick Diaz.
You ever seen the replay? That's where Nick Diaz rocked him with that right hand. See a few knees inside. Uppercut, and bang, that right hand to the top of the head.
Punches, and when you break that clinch, you throw that fucking right elbow. All right, you're in the clinch, underhooks, whatever. You come out, bang, because his hands are coming down every time.
Jeremy
Horn. Don't break
Horn.
That clinch with your hands down. You listening to me?
Joe Riggs looks very exhausted.
Okay, let's go. Second stop.
Grab that stool. Grab that stool.
Okay, good job. Grab that stool.
Billy Rush.
Hit that.
And Nick Diaz is, yeah, there's Billy Rush. You know what? And that right there was a conditioning pep. I can guarantee you that Billy Rush said, "You're not tired. You're not tired. You trained harder than him. You're a bull. Go get him." That because I've heard Billy say that before.
Nick Diaz is talking. He's angry.
Well, he is the bad boy from the streets of Stockton.
Let's go!
I like that dude. I love it when he talks trash.
You know what? You love a fighter who fights with a chip on his shoulder.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he fights with a chip on his shoulder.
And he backs it up. I mean, it's not like he's a coward. He's not a bully. He likes to fight. And he likes to talk a lot of trash.
And I quote, he says, "I don't do anything else good, so I fight." And he fights pretty well.
You know what? I bet he could apply the energy he puts to fighting to anything.
You got that right.
Looks like he's bleeding now. There's the blood all over the chest of Joe Riggs, which is coming from somewhere in Nick Diaz's face. We can't see it from this angle.
UFC 57, Liddell Couture 3. Main event of the evening tonight on our pay-per-view is for the light heavyweight championship. There's a left that connects.
Absorbed, though. Nick Diaz just took it and just pressed forward. Didn't hesitate for a second. That's got to be very disheartening.
Oh, good combination again, and he caught him. So Riggs is answering here in the second round.
Nick's got a hold of a leg. Look for him to try to take Joe down. Dragging him away from the fence.
Riggs looking up, checking the clock. 3:40 remains in round number two. Uppercut from the clinch. Riggs loves to come with that right hook. Let's see if he uses it here. When he was asked who his hero is, he said Randy Couture of all of the great competitors we have seen. And we'll see Randy here tonight.
We've seen Nick Diaz fight before as a southpaw. We're seeing him fight primarily in this fight with his left hand
forward. Absolutely.
That may be because Joe Riggs is a southpaw. The best counter to a southpaw is a straight right hand in stand-up, in boxing.
Well, the recklessness that Riggs will fight with occasionally is part of his power. When he can get a little bit unorthodox, if you will, and swing for the fences, that's when he's dangerous. And now he has bloodied up Nick Diaz. Diaz is cut under his right eye. And Riggs seems to be gaining confidence here in the second round.
Perhaps. To me, it looks like he's tired. I think the weight loss is just too much for his body to maintain optimum performance levels. I think when you dry yourself out that much, it's very hard to compete in a grueling 15-minute MMA bout. 5 rounds is a long time to fight for. Excuse me, 5 minutes. And to fight 3 5-minute rounds after losing 30 pounds of water. I mean, I've seen Joe Riggs fight before at 185 pounds and just destroy people with those punches.
You know, and some people have talked about that, and including some of his training partners. You know, why not just 185? And I asked Pat Miletich that. He said, the wrestler's mentality is, Joe, go as low as you can. Go as low as you can and try to get that advantage. And sometimes you push it to the point where it becomes a disadvantage. I understand what you're saying, but that's the wrestler mentality. That's what Pat Miletich told me.
Well, I've seen that before. We saw that with Mayhem Miller. Mayhem is a huge guy. He's over 220 pounds now, probably. Oh, Nick Diaz going for an omoplata on the right-hand side. He's got the arm pinned. Look for him to stick his foot in front of Joe Riggs' face. All right, he let it go.
Yeah, Nick pulled right into guard there.
And Nick is a dangerous guard. He's got excellent triangles, good arm bars. Very good off his back. And there he throws up a triangle. He's almost got it. He let it go.
110 remains in round two.
But he's threatening. He's still got some time. He's very dangerous off his back. Nick Diaz is a finisher.
Oh, good elbow by Riggs. Mandalay Bay Event Center in a buzz here tonight. It is the hottest ticket in Las Vegas.
Good posture by Joe Riggs, avoiding the submission attempts of Nick Diaz. Nick's gonna roll into a knee bar. He's got it, he's got a foot. He's turning it over. Looks like he's gonna go for an inside heel hook. Nope, let go.
Who do you give this round to, Joe?
Nick Diaz.
All right. So it would be Nick Diaz in charge of the scorecards, because clearly round one belonged to Diaz. Good elbows, though, by Riggs.
Good elbows by Riggs. Riggs is doing some good ground and pound here, and he does have a few cuts opening up on Nick Diaz's face. And that's, you know, we saw that in Chris Liddell. He likes, oh, he's got an arm. He's rolling.
He's going to run out of time. He's going to run out of time.
Oh.
Yep, the end of round two as the horn sounds. And final round for Diaz and Riggs. You know what? I was not overly disappointed with Riggs in the second round. I think he was much better in the second round, Joe.
He did land some damaging blows from Nick Diaz's guard. He didn't do so bad in the stand-up, but again, I just feel like his energy is a little bit sapped.
All right, let's see if he's got anything left here. I do get the feeling that he can't end it on the ground, though, that if he's going to win, especially in your mind, Joe, and he's behind on the scorecard, he's going to have to swing for a big one and connect. Diaz is really tough to knock out.
Yeah, Joe Riggs is he's not incompetent on the ground. He's got very good ground skills, but Nick Diaz is really hard to catch. I mean, if Diego Sanchez couldn't catch him on the ground, it's going to be really hard for Joe Riggs to catch him.
We will be back here in exactly a month. UFC 58, Saturday, March 4th, 10 Eastern Time, 7 Pacific, live on pay-per-view. Tickets on sale now. It will be right here at the Mandalay Bay Event Center. Log on to Ticketmaster.com or UFC.com. Get your tickets for UFC 58. Rich Franklin against David Loazzo that night in the return of BJ Penn.
Nick Diaz is doing one of the things he's doing a really good job is cutting off the octagon. Doing a great job of turning angles on Joe Riggs, so not allowing Joe Riggs to plant himself and throw a punch. He knows Joe's a little tired. He's looking for the right opportunity.
Ducking under is Diaz. Diaz, as you talked about, has had some professional boxing matches. He's trained boxing with Rodney Jones, lightweight champion in his own right. So his hands are greatly improved, and we have seen his hands display prominently in a, you know, a knockout against Robbie Lawler, a TKO with strikes against Drew Fickett, and a KO with strikes against Koji Oishi.
This has got to be very, very frustrating for Joe Riggs, too, because he's used to guys going to sleep from these punches. He's got excellent hands. Nick Diaz looking to sweep, looking to get him to the ground, try to trip. Two minutes and 40 seconds left. Joe Riggs has got to do something dramatic. In my opinion, he's going to have to stop Nick Diaz to win this fight.
.215 remains in the third and final round. Frank Mir re-enters the octagon here this evening. Super Saturday in Las Vegas.
Less than 2 minutes to go. Joe's got to do something.
See if he's got some combinations left, Joe. Time with a straight right. Now he comes with that left. Diaz right there, though. Not backing up. Yeah, Riggs really, as you pointed out throughout, looks exhausted. Caught him with a right again. Loves that right hook. That didn't have a ton of power, though.
Shoots him for a takedown. He's got a leg.
Yeah, good sprawl initially by Diaz.
Nick Diaz turns out of it.
Yeah,
excellent
nifty
balance.
Nifty move there by Nick Diaz. No panic at all.
Oh, he got
caught him again. Caught him again. I'm telling you what, Riggs is trying to tee off with the combinations.
But you know what? Nick Diaz takes a tremendous punch. He takes it, absorbs it, and he looks none the worse for wear.
And down goes Diaz. But there's 54 seconds for Riggs to leave an indelible impression inside the judges' minds and capture a potential decision here.
right back to his feet as Diaz. Yep. Riggs may be getting round three.
He's throwing some good punches.
I think round two was pretty close, too, John. I really do believe round two was pretty close.
It was close.
Do you agree then?
I agree it was close, but I think the advantage went to Nick Diaz.
And how about round three here?
It's close as well.
Yeah. Straight kick. An answer. Oh, a big swing and a miss. Final seconds of the third and final round of our first fight of the evening. And we will render the judge's decision. Cindy Crawford in the house tonight. She has become a huge UFC fan.
Good comeback in that round by Joe Riggs. He showed a lot of heart gutting it out. He was clearly exhausted, fired back, did a good job, and I think probably did enough to cinch that third round.
Well, Nick Diaz, all 22 years old, and Joe Riggs went toe-to-toe. Eddie, you were right here. Eddie Bravo, Octagon side with us, and how do you score the fight?
Very, very close fight. I gave the first round to Diaz. Although Riggs landed a lot more shots in the first round, Diaz landed two big shots, dropped Riggs. So I gave the first one 10-9 to Diaz. The second round, I gave to Riggs. Diaz was stalking him, but landed no shots, really. Riggs landed a lot of shots, opened up a cut. And the last round, the deciding round, I gave it to Riggs. He landed way more shots, although Diaz was attempting takedowns. He landed a couple shots, but every shot that he threw, Riggs countered beautifully. 29-28, Joe Riggs.
All right. Interesting that Eddie Bravo gives this one to that man, Joe Riggs. And there he is, the $6 million man, Lee Majors, here to attend the UFC. This is a celebrity-packed house here tonight at the Mandalay Bay Event Center. And in the estimation of Eddie Bravo, the decision will go to Joe Riggs. Bruce Buffer has the official decision. Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action, we go to the judges' scorecards for a decision. Abe Bilardo scores the bout 29-28. Tony Weeks scores it 30-27. And Glenn Trowbridge scores the bout 29-28. For the winner, by unanimous decision, Joe Dizarre.
So Eddie Bravo was right on it. And it is a unanimous decision victory for Joe Diesel Riggs. Here's Joe Rogan.
All right, I'm here with the victor, Joe Riggs. Joe, congratulations. Did you think you won that decision?
I did, but that's one of the first decisions everyone's did in my life. Always kind of nervous. You know, he talked a whole lot of shit. He did that with Diego, but, you know, it's just part of the game. He's a good guy, you know?
Now, it looked, a couple times during the fight, it looked like you're getting tired. Was that because of all the weight loss? I mean, you're well above 200 pounds now, and you're fighting at the 170-pound limit.
Yeah, you know, it's pretty hard getting me down that low. It's real hard. It's just Billy Rush helps me so much, man. He's like an angel in my corner, man. I love him with all my heart. Him, Jeremy, my boy Jared Seaborn, Tim Sylvia. I love everybody here. Hey, Charles Barkley's in the house, baby, from Phoenix Suns. Charles Barkley, what's up, baby?
Joe, do you think you'll continue to fight at 170 or will we see you at 185 in the future?
Who knows? Wherever I'm going to go, I'm going to go. But let me say, son, my brother Jason, Andy, my dad, my mom, everybody back home, my girl Lisa, my brother just had a new baby boy. I love everybody. I love everybody in Phoenix. I'm coming home finally. I love you guys.
Congratulations, Joe Riggs, ladies and gentlemen.
The pride of the valley. And I'll tell you what, Sir Charles in the house, and he was a beloved member of the Phoenix Suns. Brazilian Babalu must defeat who many believe is clearly the greatest wrestler to ever fight in the UFC. That man would be Mike Van Arsdale.
Mike Van Arsdale, not so Babalu Sobra.
Our tale of the tape for this light heavyweight matchup is brought to you by Zions Extreme Supplements for extreme athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. Van Arsdale, 10 years the elder of the Brazilian Renato Babalu Sobral.
dangerous light heavyweight fighter who wants to keep his number one contender status in check here tonight.
The referee for this contest is Big John McCarthy.
Babalu. Van Arsdale. Set to go at 205 pounds. And let us see if Van Arsdale does have
action.
So it is Babalu victorious here tonight in cementing, if you will, his number one contender status in the light heavyweights. An opportunity to fight for the championship. Babalu with Joe.
All right, I'm here with the victor, Babalu. Babalu, congratulations. After the fight, you got on top of the octagon and you made this gesture. That's to signify the belt.
Man, I'll be back to my seat. I will see what's gonna happen. But I'm ready for my title shot. I don't know how people wait.
I definitely think people believe you deserve it. Three fantastic submissions in a row. And let's take a look at this beautiful rear naked, seeing you fighting for the title in the future. Give it up for Babalu, folks.
And Nato Babalu Sobral will sit back, become a spectator, and see who he hopes he will fight next for the light heavyweight championship. It is the return of the former heavyweight champion, Frank Mir, as he is set to take on Marcio Cruz. You know, we use the word tonight so much, trilogy. The trilogy of Liddell and Couture. But how about the odyssey that Frank Mir has had to overcome? He's got him spun. Can he finish him?
Championship. We're heading down Sahara here in Vegas, and a guy got confused with the lights. He ran it and went through and T-boned me and sent me through the air. I think where the bike was and where I was about 80 foot difference. But the car hit me on the side of the leg, so it caught my leg between the bike and the car, and so it ended up cracking my femur. The only reason why my femur can still be fixed was because it was only broken in one spot. They're like, if it had shattered your leg, you'd have been done. You never would have done any full contact sports again.
Nice ankle.
Let it go. He's out. That was impressive.
You know what? There's people who've come back from things that are so much worse that there's no way that, you know, me being who I am, that I can't come back from this.
You won the title when Frank Mir was unable to defend the title and he had to be stripped. Does that bother you? Would you like to face him now?
Of course I want to fight against Frank Mir.
Me and Narlowski is the only fight I think about all the time. In fact, it's one habit that I've had in this fight where I'm constantly having to pull back and say, okay, I'm fighting Cruz.
The adversary of Frank Mir.
I think Frank Mir made the wrong choice by choosing me for a comeback fight. But I'm a world-class champion in jiu-jitsu. I believe at the end of the night, they're going to be lifting my hand up.
He's got his back. He's got the rear naked choke. He's got it. He's sticking his tongue out. He knows it's over. Down there. Very nice.
I see him actually kind of quitting in the fight. I really kind of see him kind of break down because I'm not going to play the jiu-jitsu game with him. When we hit the ground, I'm going to use my skills to nullify his, and I think that's going to make it very hard. That's the same as a boxer trying to box somebody who doesn't want to box. It makes it very difficult. I want this fight to end with a knockout.
You know, if anyone out there is an athlete and has to recover from an injury, you realize how mentally fatiguing that is. How about a career-threatening injury?
Well, and you know, even an injury that could possibly have resulted in an amputation. You know, that's one of the things about femur injuries when they're shattered like that and snapped. Like, sometimes they don't heal properly. They don't get enough blood flow. They have knee damage. Oh, it's a horrible, horrible injury. And still, to this day, we said before, he's got a big titanium rod in the middle of it.
You know, it's interesting, Joe, because we have talked and talked before about the possibility of losing Frank Mir as a competitor in the UFC because of that September 2004 motorcycle accident.
I mean, that was a huge loss to the MMA community. That fight was, everybody was talking about Arlovsky, Frank Mir in the UFC. It was a huge title bout. Now, he's been out over a year since then. He's had to go through all sorts of extensive rehab, healing, training again, getting back into shape again. We're going to see. We're going to have a lot of answers tonight from Frank Mir.
All right, let's get fight specific real quickly here. If you're Marcio Cruz, do you go right after that leg?
No, he's got to get it to the ground. Okay. Marcio Cruz's advantage is 100% on the ground. Marcio Cruz, we've seen him in the octagon before, and he's an excellent jiu-jitsu fighter, but a very novice striker. I'm sure he's improved since the Atlantic City bout, but you got to think the advantage goes to Mir in the stand-up. He wants to get down on the ground. He wants to get down on the ground and get down on the ground quick.
All right, let's see what happens as we are set for the return of former heavyweight champion Frank Mir, set to take on a man equally as talented as he on the ground with jiu-jitsu, that being Marcio Cruz. Tale of the Tape, brought to you by Zion's Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. The 27-year-old Brazilian against the 26-year-old American. A big reach advantage for Cruz, but again, as Joe has talked about, he will not be looking to strike with Frank Mir.
When the action begins, our referee in charge of the octagon is Herb Dean.
Frank Mir is so cerebral in his approach to this game, and he is cerebral right now. He's been waiting a long time to return. It is Mir against Cruz in a heavyweight matchup.
You ready? Come on, let's do it.
Is tonight the start of the road back to a potential battle with Arlovsky in regaining his belt? Comes out swinging. Does Frank Mir, remember, it's the left leg that was damaged in the accident.
Oh, looked like it just gave out right there.
Yep, Mir slipped a little bit. He has put it to the test. Not only how is his leg,
beautiful takedown.
How is his head, the mental part of it.
Pedipano rolling for an armbar. Good body shot by Frank Mir from the top.
The one thing that Frank has talked about is that he said, as a pure submission guy, yeah, perhaps Cruz is better than I am with that jiu-jitsu background, but so was Roberto Traven. But when fists start flying, Joe, that changes this game from just pure jiu-jitsu or submission wrestling.
Absolutely, changes everything. Things open up. Rolling for a Kimura is Frank Mir. He might have this locked up. It's hard to see with his hands, if he's got it locked up with his hands. Pedipano dropping some punches and elbows on Frank's side to try to soften him up here. It's very difficult to tell from this vantage point if he's got his arms locked. Looks like Pedipano's getting out now. He's slowly slipping his elbow up. Once his elbow passes Frank Mir's elbow, he's going to be safe. Right, he's out. Head arm control. He's in Frank's half guard. But this is Pedipano's world. Pedipano is an excellent Brazilian jiu-jitsu fighter.
Caught him with an elbow. Caught him with an elbow, and Mir is cut. Oh, a good elbow indeed. Marcio Cruz following up with a shot to the left eye area of Frank Mir. So Mir is opened up.
Yeah, Frank Mir's got to figure out a way to somehow or another get out of this position.
And that blood's going right in his eye. Blood's going right in his eye. That's going to affect his vision with the cut being right in. It's clean break. They're going
to
check the cut over the left eye of Frank Mir, and they will return to this position.
Okay, up.
They're going to check the cut, and then they will return to this position.
Ooh. Wow, that's a lot of blood.
Yep.
Oh, this would be very unfortunate if the fight would stop because of this.
The doctor's saying if you can't see, we can stop the fight. I don't think Frank's going to allow that to happen. He says he can't wait. He can't see. He can't see out of the left. The cut's fine.
Can't see out of his left eye.
Can't see out of his left eye.
It's your call. Can you continue to fight?
Cut's fine.
He's fine.
You can.
We're
going back down there.
Yep.
Down.
Better baby, Frank.
I can't see out of my left eye, but I'll still fight.
Wow.
And remember, they can't give any more attention to the cut till the end of the round, Joe. So it might be survival mode right here with still 2 minutes and 30 seconds remaining in round number one. Then they can probably close that cut up. But right now, he's going to have to survive the next couple of minutes.
And it's going to get bigger.
Yep.
Pedipano's landed punches and elbows on it. I mean, right on the, and Frank's not doing anything to defend that. He's got to figure out some way to stop these punches from landing on that cut.
Frank Mir, the former heavyweight champion, is in big trouble here in round one. Marcio Cruz, Pedipano, out of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Teammate of Babalu, doing a great job against the former heavyweight champion, who has been out for over a year.
Frank keeps rolling, trying to get this Kimura, but in the meantime, he's taking a pounding.
I remember when he was beaten so badly by Ian Freeman, but that was truly, truly the mistake of being overconfident made by Frank Mir that night. And he said he still has pictures of how he looked after that fight. Said he'll never make that mistake again. If he can survive the next 90 seconds, round one will go to Cruz, but he'll be able to get that cut closed.
The cut has only gotten worse. And if you couldn't see out of his eye before, I mean, that's nasty. He's got a minute and 20 seconds to go.
Long time. It's got to fight back.
Fight back!
The Las Vegas crowd is in favor of Frank Mir, but Frank is in big trouble here in round one.
Herb Dean is thinking of stopping this fight. That's why he's saying fight back.
Fighter must be able to intelligently defend himself, and Cruz is in total control. Surprise here in round one.
Fight back! I'm gonna stop it!
Gotta fight back or he'll stop it. It is all over! It is all over! Marcio Cruz has defeated Frank Mir!
Pedipano wins by ground and pound. Who would have ever thought that was gonna happen?
Frank
Once he got
Mir
to the ground, it was his, he was completely in control.
Could not intelligently defend himself. And the return is sincerely and drastically disappointing for Frank Mir.
Let's take a look at the replay and see the punch in the elbow that did the damage to Frank Mir's eye.
Oh.
There's a punch.
That's the one that got him. Yeah, it was the punch that opened him up, Joe.
Yeah, those elbows didn't really do it. There was another elbow. It was more the punch that did it. And then afterwards, a bunch of punches and a bunch of elbows.
You know, you wonder if he could have survived and done something to defend himself, you know, 30 seconds later and stopped the bleeding. Could he have regained any control? But we won't be able to find that out now as Cruz just continued to throw and throw aggressively against Frank Mir. So surprise, surprise here at the Mandalay Bay Event Center. Cruz upsets Mir and goes to 2-0 in the UFC. Here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Herb Dean has called a stop to this contest at 4 minutes, 10 seconds of the very first round. For the winner by referee stoppage and TKO, Marcio Pedipano Cruz.
So Herb Dean stops the fight in the first round, and definitively the victor is Pedipano Marcio Cruz. Here's Joe.
All right, I'm here with the winner, Marcio Pedipano Cruz, world jiu-jitsu champion, second fight in MMA, defeats UFC heavyweight champion, former UFC heavyweight champion.
Talk us through the replay.
A luta foi boa, e eu ganhei.
All right, now congratulations on a fantastic victory.
Eu queria fazer uma homenagem a dos maiores mestres de jiu-jitsu de todos os tempos, que faleceu essa semana. Grande abraço do fundo do meu coração, esteja ele onde ele estiver. Sei que ele está torcendo por mim, sempre gostou muito de mim. Agradecer ao mestre Carson Grace.
He just made a homenage for Carson Grace, who just died. He was a legend for jiu-jitsu, 70 years old, just passed out this week.
Absolutely.
Pedipano, ladies and gentlemen.
All right, I'm here with former UFC heavyweight champion Frank Mir. Frank, long time layoff. You had a huge injury. This is your fight back. You've got to be disappointed. Tell us what you're thinking.
Greatly disappointed. Just too much time off. I thought I was ready. I guess I think sometimes as a fighter, you convince yourself you're invincible. And I think I should have been more honest with myself. But it's just one more thing that I have to deal with now. I'm not out of it. This is definitely a stumble. I'll get up and keep running. All you can do. I can't give up.
What's next for you now? How much time do you take off and you go right back to the gym?
I kind of feel like going to training tonight to get past this. I don't know, you know, just you lick your wounds, you're depressed, you cry about it, and Monday, pick myself up and get going. I have no choice but to keep going. Anytime in life something knocks you down, you got to stand back up. It's part of being a man.
Well, Frank, you have a lot of fans here, a lot of people rooting for you, and a lot of people who love to see you make a comeback.
Thank you.
Frank Mir, ladies and gentlemen.
Mike Goldberg, Joe Rogan setting out for the heavyweights. Heavy-handed Miletic fighter Justin Eilers trying to put the setbacks behind him. And truth be told, Eilers' game plan tonight is to rip his opponent's head off.
Heavyweight contender Justin Eilers loves nothing more than knocking out an opponent in devastating fashion, as Mike Kyle found out in Eilers' UFC debut at UFC 49. Eilers always comes looking for a war and really tried to take it to heavyweight champion Andrei Arlovsky at UFC 53 before blowing out his knee towards the end of the first round. Now Eilers is healed up and is looking to add to his knockout total in his octagon return.
I like to fight. I like to stand and throw leather. And, you know, I like fighting opponents that want to do that as well.
Brandon the Truth Vera is a brown belt in jiu-jitsu and has won many submission competitions, but he has become known lately for his dangerous striking ability. At Ultimate Fight Night, Vera showed what he could do against the much larger Fabiano Scherner, finishing him with knees at 3 minutes and 22 seconds of the second round. At 5-0, many people think that Vera has what it takes to be a real contender.
Justin is kind of crazy. Like, he doesn't have any regard for his own personal safety. He's already missing a tooth. He doesn't care if he gets hit. He said he'd fight his own mom. It's going to make for an interesting fight.
Coming up next, Justin Eilers takes on Brandon the Truth Bearer.
Our Tale of the Tape brought to you by Zion's Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. Pretty much everything is equal. There is a 3-inch reach advantage for Brandon Vera, but he is very comfortable on the ground. If you assess everything that he has in his arsenal, he's least comfortable on his feet, so we may not see that reach advantage being a big factor.
Begins. Our referee in charge of this contest is Mario Yamasaki.
Heavyweight matchup between Brandon the Truth Vera and hard-hitting Miletic product Justin Eilers.
All right, are you ready? Are you ready? Let's go!
So here we go. Eilers will undoubtedly try to swing for the fences early. Big, powerful man who's been with the Miletic fighting systems, the MFS elite team, as Joe talked about earlier, for the last 3 years, training with Jeremy Horn and Pat Miletic, Matt Hughes, Jens Pulver, the entire team in Davenport, Iowa. And remember, prior to his back-to-back losses against Buentello and Arlovsky, neither of those should be taken as a negative when you consider the depth of talent there. He had won 6 straight fights, all by KO or TKO, Justin Eilers.
He looked very impressive in his victory over Mike Kyle.
Yes.
Huge left hook to win that fight. He took it to Mike Kyle. He looked great on his feet, but he is coming off 2 KO losses in a row, and that's got to play on your confidence. I mean, his Stop. Image before that was of a super tough guy that was just willing to take punishment. And after being KO'd twice, as we said before, he is the greatest kickboxer of all time. Widely recognizes that. When that guy's impressed with you, that means a lot. Well, and now we see why.
That should help solidify what we talked about before, that Brandon Vera could very well be the next big thing.
Absolutely. And again, he's a small heavyweight. We're talking about a guy who's fighting at 220 pounds. He could easily drop down to 205. I mean, Joe Riggs is almost 223 pounds, and he fights at 170. Let's take a look at the replay. The last punch was just for good measure.
Brandon the Truth Vera. Bam.
And again.
I think that straight kick that caught him the second time. Almost caught him with the shin there, Joe, is what knocked out Justin Eilers. So Brandon Vera continues to be undefeated in his mixed martial arts career. Nice job, the Truth.
Yeah!
Here is Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Mario Yamasaki has called a stop to this contest at 1 minute 25 seconds of the very first round. For the winner by knockout, Brandon the Truth Vera.
Paris Hilton has to be impressed with the skills displayed a moment ago by Brandon the Truth Vera.
I am here with the Truth. Brandon Vera gets better every time we see you here in the octagon. Talk to us about that fight. Give us your impressions of it.
Man, just came out swinging like a bat out of hell. Hit me with a 1-2. I grabbed him in the clinch. Please stop hitting me. The ref helped me out, recentered us. Man, I kicked him in the head, kneed him in the face. Call it a day, baby. Get my check.
All right, let's take a look at the big screen and talk us through the knockout.
We've been working southpaw. Rob came in, head kick, full shin. He's dizzy. Bang, knee. Land, went for Mr. Yamasaki, help him out. We got in the match, we got in the fight. UFC, thank you so much. Everybody, thank you for the support. City Boxing, Team Lloyd Irvin, my boys at the Bomb Squad, Rob Kamen, Master Lloyd, my manager Mark Dion. I love everybody.
Now, Brandon, you're a relatively small heavyweight at 220 pounds, and you've talked about winning the heavyweight title and winning the light heavyweight title. Is that still in your plans?
It's definitely still in my plans. The first time I was out, I told everybody what my goals and what my intentions were. I'm not coming here just to collect a paycheck and just to be an okay fighter. My goal is to become champion one day. I hope you guys stand behind me, and I'm gonna keep working every day to get to that goal.
Well, as a fan, I look forward to watching that. Brandon the Truth Vera!
Anticipation is building for this, our main event of the evening. Never has there been so much excitement surrounding a single fight as we complete what is the trilogy, a thrilling one at that, with Liddell Couture 3. We have waited our entire UFC lives for this one. This is the main event of the evening. This is the main event of UFCs of all time. This is the time in which Randy Couture and Chuck Liddell will finally settle the score. Randy defeated Chuck decisively in the first ever matchup. Shocking to some that he was able to outstrike the world-class striker. He used dirty boxing. He took him down at will. 22 months later, though, Randy the Natural Couture was knocked out for the first time in his UFC career, and we had a new light heavyweight champion. He was Chuck, the Iceman Liddell. What will happen tonight? And when will that question be answered? When will Father Time finally catch up to this 42-year-old legend?
When's he gonna retire? He's starting to slow down. Every fight, they evaluate my performance. Oh, he looks slower. I don't know, he should think about getting out. It's the same thing every single fight. This fight's no different. Take it one fight at a time. I haven't looked past this fight. It'd be crazy to look past it.
Oh my goodness, the wait is finally over. Let's get fight specific, Joe Rogan. I think if there's the biggest improvement made in Chuck Liddell over the last few years, it may be as simple as his conditioning.
His conditioning has been fantastic over the last few years. The experience level, I mean, you gotta think about the guys he's fought, Vernon Tiger White, he knocked out Jeremy Horn. He's been on a fantastic roll. His confidence is soaring.
Randy the Natural Couture told me verbatim, I will not get into a heavily rushed pace like I did, making the mistake in the second meeting. When he got poked in the eye in the second meeting, Randy told me, Joe, he got angry, he got overly aggressive, he became vulnerable. He will not make that mistake tonight.
I don't think he thought he could be knocked out before. He had gone through heavyweight bouts with Pedro Hizo and Josh Barnett, gigantic guys, withstood their blows, especially Pedro Hizo, who's a knockout artist at 240 pounds. He thought he was able to take a better punch than he was. Chuck caught him on the button, and he learned what a lot of people learn. You can't take shots on the button. No one can. You eventually get knocked out.
Two of the greatest in UFC history about to fight for the belt at 205 pounds. Superstars in the house make their predictions, including Sir Charles.
I met Chuck at the Playboy Mansion on Halloween with his girlfriend, Willa. And they invited my boyfriend and I tonight, so I want Chuck to win, and I think he is.
Well, unfortunately, I think Chuck will win it. I'm a huge Randy fan, but you know, I think it's Chuck's time.
I mean, for me, I'd say if I did have to pick a winner, I'd say it'd be Chuck in the second, or it'd be Randy in the third.
Well, you know what? I get killed by half of this crowd if I make a prediction. I just want it to be a great fight. I can't make these people, they love their guys. So I don't want to piss anybody off.
All right, I have to say that's the first time Charles has really thought about that.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Charles Barkley not wanting to piss people off. What's the world coming to?
Yeah, absolutely. Here we have the Natural.
some obscure place in the middle of nowhere. Here he is, UFC light heavyweight champion, millionaire, superstar, athlete, probably the first ever in mixed martial arts.
He has the all-time UFC win record with 12 victories inside the octagon. Most importantly, one of those against Randy, the natural Couture, and oh, how his life has changed since he knocked out the future Hall of Famer. Our tale of the tape for this main event of the evening is brought to you by Zion's Extreme Supplements for Extreme Athletes, available at GNC stores nationwide. 6 years the elder, Randy, the natural Couture, the reach advantage does belong to the Iceman, who will try to keep this fight on the feet. Couture wants to throw Chuck Liddell down. We have waited and waited and waited some more, and now it is here. It is time for the official introductions. The veteran voice of the octagon, Bruce Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this UFC championship bout is sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, with Chairman Skip Avancino Jr. and Commissioners Dr. Tony Alamo, John Bailey, Joe W. Brown, and TJ Day, and Executive Director Mark Ratner. Our judges at Octagon side are Nelson Hamilton, Cecil Peoples, and Jeff Mullen. And our lead doctor is Dr. Jeff Davidson. When the action begins, our referee in charge of the Octagon is Big John McCarthy. This event is sponsored by Zions, extreme supplements for extreme athletes, available in GNC stores nationwide. And New Line Cinema's film, Running Scared, in theaters Friday, February 24th. Ladies and gentlemen, these two UFC warriors have faced off against each other twice before in the octagon. And now, it's time to go to war one last time again. Live from the sold-out arena here at the Mandalay Bay Resort and Casino.
Okay, gentlemen, you received your instructions in your locker rooms. Not any questions from the challenger?
No, sir.
Any questions from the champion? Fight clean, fight hard, fight fair, touch gloves, let's go.
Randy the Natural Couture against Chuck the Iceman Liddell. Finally, they will settle the score. Exploding upon the future Hall of Famer, Randy the Natural Couture.
Wow. That happened so fast. Let's take a look at the replay. That happens.
The slip by Randy Couture leaves him vulnerable, and with Chuck the Iceman Liddell well on his way to legendary status, if he has not already attained that moniker, explodes upon him in a split second, and he remains the UFC light heavyweight champion, and he wins this final matchup with Randy the Natural Couture. Liddell has never been so sharp. Liddell has never been so dominant. A relieved Willa Ford. He is on top of the world right now, and justifiably so. A standing ovation for the light heavyweight champion, Chuck Liddell. Here's Joe.
Chuck Liddell, another victory, another brutal knockout. Give us your thoughts on the fight.
Well, first off, if you want to come party with me, I'll be at Empire Ballroom, it's Old Utopia.
They're about 10, 11. Anyway, thank my sponsors, Cobb 28, Zions especially. I got Marley Powers and Valley Ford. Hey, thanks, guys. And Hanford. All right,
Chuck, we're going to talk us through the knockout. Take a look at the big screen and talk us through this.
Well, we knew Randy was going to try to either lay back or cover hard, make me overcommit. So I just kind of moved around, was trying to pick my shots. I mean, if you let me stand in front of you that long, sooner or later I'm going to catch one, put you down.
All right, now, Chuck, Renato Babalu Sobral, a victim of yours in an earlier fight, wants a rematch. He's been winning a lot of fights. A lot of people think he's the number one contender in the 205-pound division. What are your thoughts on that?
I think he's a tough guy, a great fighter, and you know me, I'll fight anybody. So
we know you. You will fight anybody, and we love watching it. Folks, give it up for the Iceman, Chuck Liddell.
The Iceman, Chuck Liddell, knocks out Randy the Natural Couture and retains his UFC light heavyweight championship belt. Defended his title at the MGM Grand down the road against Jeremy Horn, and now he defeats the legendary Couture, who is with Joe.
All right, I'm here with Randy. Randy, second fight with Chuck in a row. You've been knocked out. What are your thoughts on the fight? What are your thoughts on your future in general?
You know, first of all, I give praise to God for everything that he's done in my life. This has been an amazing journey for me. Chuck's a great champion. It's a true honor every time I get in here with him. He demonstrated that warrior spirit every single time. And my hat's off to him. He caught me again tonight. I was prepared and as prepared as I've ever been for a fight. So hats off to him.
Is this the end of the line for you, Randy?
This is the last time you're going to see these gloves and these shorts in this octagon. I'm retiring tonight. I want to thank all my fans for all their support. That's it for me. I'm ready to do something else.
Randy, as a fan, it's been an honor to watch you compete. It's been an honor to watch you elevate the level of class and dignity and the championship spirit that you showed throughout your career. You're loved by millions of fans across the world, and we all appreciate everything that you've done.
Thank you. I've got a great family, a great girlfriend, Kim Holderman, a great group of friends that have helped me prepare for this and throughout my career. I feel blessed to have been able to come in here and compete. Thank you, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, one of the greatest champions in UFC history, Randy the Natural Couture.
Understanding the significance of what Chuck Liddell just achieved is undeniable. He defeated a legend for a second straight time, knocking him out for a second straight time. But looking at the big picture and the long and storied career of that man puts what is a joyous night for Chuck Liddell and turns it in to a sad night for UFC fans, because never again will we see the Natural Randy Couture inside the world famous octagon. Class extraordinaire, defeated by a younger and more dangerous champion in Chuck Liddell. The journey began in 1997 when this wrestler from just outside of Portland, Oregon, said, "I'm going to turn into an ultimate fighter." He became our first five-time champion, first man with a title in two weight classes, and we will never see that again, as Randy Couture, one of the greatest champions and most unbelievably classy individuals in the history of mixed martial arts, bids farewell to the Ultimate Fighting Championship.
Our submission of the night brought to you by our good friends at Tap Out. Tap Out clothing, wear it inyourface.com. And I'll tell you what, it was a glorious return to the UFC for none other than Jeff Munson, who did a great job against Brandon Lee Hinkle.
He looks fantastic, much improved. The Snowman finishes off Brandon Hinkle with a choke from the north-south position. Hinkle taps and goes to sleep.
And so our submission of the night belongs to the heavyweight fighter, Jeff Munson. Submission of the night brought to you by our friends at TapOut at InYourFace.com. It is now quiet here inside the Mandalay Bay Event Center. And Joe, you ask the fighters this question all the time after a definitive finish like we saw with Randy and Chuck. What are your emotions right now?
You know, you said it best, bittersweet. I am a fan of both of these guys, a huge fan, and I'm honored to have watched Randy compete. You know, we've seen him for the last time in the octagon, the last time competing, and it's been a treat. I mean, this is an amazing man who's really raised the level of performance, raised the level of class. I mean, he's just a phenomenal athlete, an amazing guy, and it's just, he's had a fantastic career, and I'm just so happy that I was there to watch it and there to broadcast some of his fights.
You know, knowing Joe as well as I do, I know he doesn't throw around the word hero very lightly, but I will tell you, Randy Couture is both of our heroes. Disappointment and despair. What is next? Mr. Cruz asked, as we all do, of Frank Mir. Here's one that we think might not miss. It is the truth that everybody loves, Brandon Vera. Will he perhaps get a chance at Andre Arlovsky someday? And then it was the main event of the evening. The Iceman against the Natural for a third and final time. The result the same as we saw in their second meeting, solidifying the championship status of that man. From San Luis Obispo, Chuck Liddell. For everyone here at Zuffa and the Ultimate Fighting Championship, we will see you in March. So long, Randy.